Welcome everyone to today's Council on Foreign Relations virtual Robert B. Menschel Economics Symposium session, Economic Behavior in a Pandemic, with Ravi Dhar, Wendy Edelberg, and Fiona Gregg. I'm Terry Babcock-Lumish, Executive Secretary of the Harry S. Truman Scholarship Foundation, and I'll be presiding over today's discussion. This symposium, presented by the Maurice R. Greenberg Center for Geoeconomic Studies, is made possible by the generous support of Robert B. Menschel. Dovetailing on Professor Thaler's keynote yesterday, we have a remarkable panel assembled to discuss how the pandemic has altered consumer decision-making and economic behavior, how these trends affect the U.S. and global economy, and ultimately how behavioral economics can help us understand these shifts. Our psychologist, Ravi Dhar, is the George Rogers Clark Professor of Management and Marketing and directs Yale's Center for Customer Insights. A widely respected macroeconomist, Wendy Edelberg, is joining us from Brookings Hamilton Project. She previously served as CBO's chief economist. And Fiona Gregg is the managing director and co-president of the JP Morgan Chase Institute. As we want to make sure we're understanding this past year's economic shifts from global to the very local, I particularly appreciate that Fiona comes to us with a local government experience of having served as Philadelphia's deputy budget director. Ravi, let's go ahead and begin with you. This last year, we have all witnessed consumers reacting in ways some might consider curious. We could certainly argue whether they're rational or irrational, from hoarding toilet paper and Lysol wipes to saying that they won't order Corona beer. But let's go ahead and break it down, given your work. I thought it was particularly vivid to learn from you that 75%, that's amazing, 75% of consumers have tried a new store, brand, or different way of shopping during the pandemic. Could you perhaps kick us off by providing a snapshot of the ways in which consumer behaviors and choices have changed?
Yes, thank you, Terry. When you look at behavior changes, you can look at what I call the four W's, if you like. The first W could be what are they buying? You mentioned, you know, toilet paper and beer. Some of it is not particularly insightful here, right? No one had much reasons to travel, go to theaters or sports, so obviously not much of that's ticket sales are happening, if you like. So that's one W we can get into, you know, and if you look at it very in a nuanced way, like apparel, you know, apparel was down, but if you look at sleepwear or pajamas or casual stuff, you know, that went up massively, but stuff you wear when you go out for parties went down dramatically. So that's the one W that, you know, people look at, the what are people buying? The second, I think we'll get into a little later, which is who is doing the buying? Given the income inequality, you know, who's actually doing the buying if you start looking at more granular thing? I actually want to start with the third W, which is where is this behavior happening? You know, so if you can look at the two big points we measure is the point of purchase and point of consumption. So not surprisingly, if you look at point of purchase, there has been a big flight to digital, right? If you look at e-commerce, a lot of benefit has gone to the big retailers, big stores that had an e-commerce capability. The small retailers, small stores did not have it. But there's also something interesting here. When I looked at the data, if you look at something like McDonald's or quick service restaurants, most of the buying happened in drive-thrus, not at home. Why was that the case? I think people already used drive-thrus. They were familiar with it. You drive there in your car and you were felt safe. So drive-thru sales were as high as 90%. Right. And at-home sales were around 5 to 10% for these quick service restaurants, which surprised me compared to many other places where a lot of the delivery was happening at home. Even when you break it down by curbside versus home delivery, curbside went up quite a bit. It's almost as if people wanted to get the hell out of home somewhere and pick up their groceries. So that's about the point of purchase. You can also look at point of consumption. You know, where is it happening? Not surprisingly, since you couldn't go to work, you couldn't go to restaurants, most of the consumption was happening at home. So no TGIF, no eating breakfast on the fly. So if you look at places like McDonald's, they found the breakfast sales went down because people were not having breakfast on the fly or a coffee on the fly, whereas lunch and dinner sales actually went up for these places. But even more than places like McDonald's, it went up at pizza. Why? Because pizza can be shared with the family. You can buy for the whole family, and McDonald's had to really scramble to make this family size kind of meals because they were not set up traditionally to do that. So when you start looking very granularly, you start seeing winners and losers. Winners in e-commerce were really the large, familiar brands with supply chain, sufficient inventory, who actually were doing pretty bad before the COVID hit, you know, like Campbell's, Kellogg's, the Bud Lights, because people wanted to try the niche brands. But once you moved online rapidly, the rich brands, the small niche brands did not really have the inventory, the supply chain, or the direct-to-consumer model that they could benefit with. So it's very fascinating that when you start looking at it very granularly, you start noticing these differences. Even in telemedicine, for example, what you find is the telemedicine started taking off only when the consumer saw a benefit in it. You know, when I talked to the companies before the COVID crisis, and they were trying to, they were telling me, you know, Ravi, help me do behavior change, help me drive people to telemedicine. And at that time, the consumer's reaction or the patient's reaction was, why should I do this? This benefits you. It lowers your cost. It doesn't give me any benefit. So ironically, some of these same things prior to the pandemic, people thought, there's no reason for me to change my behavior. All the benefit and the cost savings goes to the HMO. But suddenly telemedicine became very popular post, you know, the COVID, because people saw the benefit of these things. So if I look at the third W, like where is this all happening? I think that's where a lot of exciting stuff is happening, the point of purchase and point of consumption.
Fascinating. I just want to follow up very briefly, because behavioral insights help us understand how people respond when they don't feel that they have control over risk. And really, we know that emotional response then is amplified. Can you just give us a little bit more texture here? Because I think you're nibbling at it, and we know you have some real insight into to how we've managed risk or managed perhaps our feeling as if we are managing risk.
Right. So I think there are two issues here. One is the beliefs. What do people believe about, you know, what is my belief about e-commerce, or what are you telling me to purchase? In general, consumers believe that you want me to change my behavior so that it benefits you. So when I talked to the banking industry, and banking industry was driving people to use e-commerce or a financial instruments, you know, a financial services payments company, let's call them one of the two big ones, they were trying to drive people to contactless or digital wallets. And most people think, nah, you know, it works pretty well. The card does pretty well. Why do I need a contactless, right? And similarly, when they found, when you try to change behaviors, people have a reaction that I'm losing control and you're doing it for your benefit. And when the pandemic hit, suddenly the benefit of contactless was pretty obvious, right, to the consumer. I don't want to touch somebody. I don't want my card to be touched by somebody else. And suddenly there was this big opportunity. And if you look at what happened in this business for the payment businesses, a lot of the people who are providing the digital services went up dramatically. So I think more generally, I think not only consumers have more control, but they feel the attribution that they make for the change in behavior is for their own benefit, as opposed to the benefit of the, you know, the seller here. And that's really what drove some of the changes.
Makes solid sense for sure. Fiona, let's get you in here. You and your colleagues have had an extraordinary window into household spending and savings behavior this last year. So could you help us understand from your own findings on the direct effects of the pandemic, as well as those resulting labor market disruptions?
Yeah, certainly. Well, one of the things that we all know about this pandemic is that it has disproportionately impacted low-income families in terms of where the job losses occurred, disproportionately among Black and Hispanic families, workers, women. And at the same time, you know, we've seen one of the largest fiscal expansions our country has, you know, ever seen, right? Enormous packages, now three of them, that not only put tons of cash in the hands of families in the form of stimulus payments, but also expanded unemployment insurance to historic levels. Actually, you know, 7% of total income in July came from unemployment insurance alone. When never before had that budged above, you know, 2% even in prior recessions. And a couple of things have been remarkable as we kind of trace the impacts of both the job losses and the fiscal supports through the economy. The first is that actually, if, you know, labor income fell the most for low-income families, but total income was up. And that's because unemployment insurance, with those $600 supplements and then $300 supplements, more than replaced pre-job loss earnings for most workers. And so with that additional support, we actually saw that spending recovered most quickly for low-income families, precisely the families who had been experiencing job loss. Those are the families for whom we observe spending increasing the most. And what was remarkable is that at a, you know, their spending was increasing above their own baseline at a time when the spending of the employed had dropped dramatically, right? We saw spending drop by 30, 40 percentage points. And yet the spending of people who had lost their job and received unemployment insurance had been boosted by 10 or so percent above their own baseline. So in many ways, it's the spending of jobless workers who were, you know, fueling our economy. And from a behavioral standpoint, it was number one, noteworthy that their spending was above their own baseline. Number two, it was noteworthy that those increases were durable in the sense that even with those, you know, with stimulus, with unemployment insurance, we also saw their cash balances increase quite a bit, right? So at year end, cash balances were up by 30, 40% year over year. And we saw that families spending increased, you know, to an increase of jobless benefits in, you know, when the $300 came out, even when their liquidity levels were high, right? Normally we think that, you know, marginal propensity to consume is highest when people are most cash poor, right? When they are most liquidity constrained is when we would expect people to exhibit a high marginal propensity to consume. And yet we saw this high marginal propensity to consume time and time again throughout the year, even as those cash balances were increasing as a result of that generous support. We saw it, them very responsive to the $300 supplements and unemployment insurance. We were seeing again a high responsiveness to the January stimulus. So number one, we're seeing people be very responsive to this stimulus in terms of their spending response, even when they have liquidity. The second thing that we've seen is that, you know, one of the big concerns with, you know, very generous jobless benefits is that you might incur moral hazard, right? You might see that people would be deterred from working, or they might stay unemployed for longer if, you know, unemployment benefits are generous in both level and duration. And yet what we observed is very little impact of these supplemental benefits on work. So when we measured people going back to work by virtue of exits out of unemployment insurance, we saw that actually, if you just focus on the people who received those $600 supplements, UI supplements, more than half of them exited before those supplements expired, right? They expired at the end of July. And in fact, more than half of those jobless workers had already gone back to work. So they weren't waiting for those generous benefits to expire. They went back to work before that. And we only saw a very, very temporary increase in returning to work when those jobless benefit, you know, when that $600 supplement expired. So that suggests that, you know, either people obviously prefer to work than, you know, cash in hand. Working generates experience, it generates, right, you know, less risk, obviously, than even a generous jobless benefit. But it may also imply that the costs associated with searching for a job during a pandemic were very high, right? It's hard to network on Zoom. It's hard to do coffee chats. It's hard to, you know, it's hard to do all the normal things that go along with a job search. So those are a couple of the, you know, the key trends is just this big boost in spending to low-income workers by virtue of this fiscal support, very little impact on job search that we might have otherwise been worried about. And I think as we look into 2021, you know, we saw already cash balances were quite elevated. Again, they were going into the end of 2020, of course, with the January stimulus, they're going to be elevated again. Tax time puts another big boost into people's cash balances. And so, and yet it does seem like probably the thing that's going to make people, you know, come out and spend even more, aside from this cash, which does seem to stimulate people's spending, is the vaccines. So those are a few reflections, Terry.
Which are fantastic, Fiona. Thank you so much. We're definitely going to explore this some more. But Wendy, I want to come to you next, because your and your colleagues' work on the pandemic-induced changes to our economy is just particularly relevant here as we consider these tectonic shifts, and Fiona spoke into some of this, as has Ravi, in terms of consumption, but also in our workplaces, where we're working, how we're working, the stark realities of how Americans have experienced this last year's pandemic in very different ways. So let me just begin with the very basic question of how has this recession been different?
Oh, I mean, how has it not been different? But one of the critical ways that it's been different, relating to what we've all been talking about, is the different kinds of spending that have been most affected. So what's remarkable is that, putting aside increases in or the maintaining of spending at takeout restaurants that I think Ravi focused on a little bit, much of the spending increases that we've seen since the beginning of the pandemic have actually come in the form of durables, which is extraordinarily unusual for a recession. Usually what we see during times of when the whole economy is in recession or for a particular household, when they're experiencing financial stress, is that they postpone the big ticket purchases. You can make the refrigerator work for a little bit longer. You can, or if you're going to buy a replacement car, you're going to buy a cheaper replacement car because, you know, and buy a used car because you're worried about your family's finances. And in fact, then on the flip side, what we see about those same durables purchases is that when the economy is coming out of recession, and where we look for with spending booms is particularly for a surge in spending on durables. Well, everything is flipped now in the current recession, where we're seeing remarkable increases in spending is exactly on durables. So the share durables as a share of GDP is right now over 8%. It's been over 8% through the entire second half on average of 2020. That's actually the highest that it's been since 2007. So we've seen just remarkable strength in durable spending. Okay, so where have we seen weakness in spending? Perhaps this won't surprise anybody, but it's been in services, and particularly in services that require face-to-face interaction. So here's some numbers that I have on my screen. So recreation services is down 30% since pre-pandemic. Transportation is down 25%. Food services, so people eating inside restaurants primarily, that's down 20%. And what might be a little bit more surprising for folks is that healthcare services are down 5%. That's a lot less, but that category is actually quite large and comprises a very large share of household spending. So we have basically, as a society, postponed just about any kind of healthcare expenditure or healthcare service that we can possibly postpone. So those are exactly the places where we're looking for strength in spending over the next year as we come out of the pandemic and as people spend spend the money that they've saved over the past year. So with the Biden package in hand, with having enacted the $1.9 trillion package, my projection is that the economy is poised to rise about 8%. Over the course of 2021. That is a remarkably fast pace of growth, and actually will get GDP above its where we would have expected it to be pre-pandemic at the end of 2021. And we will continue to see pretty remarkable strength in the economy through the end of 2021 and through early 2022. So again, I think much of that is going to come in the form of spending on services, which will probably create all sorts of difficult composition effects as restaurants manage the incredible increase in demand that they face, as healthcare providers manage the incredible surge in demand that they face. So we will probably see some inflation spikes in some categories and some bottlenecks there. And then thinking then longer term, how do we expect the composition of our economy to change post-pandemic? Well, so many of the things that we've been talking about today, like so many of the technological changes that Ravi was talking about, we're not going to forget those technological changes. We're not going to forget how to have virtual conferences just like the ones we're having right now. And as a result, we're going to see pretty remarkable changes, I think, in the way we do business. So we're going to see fewer people commuting into downtown business districts to do face-to-face interaction during the course of a business day. That's going to have important and disruptive changes on the people who work in the service sectors that provide services to those folks who worked in downtown business districts. We're going to see changes in how grocery stores operate. We're going to see changes in the way healthcare services are offered. And I do worry that we don't have the policies in place right now to make those transitions less painful. They're going to be painful. People are going to return to what appears to be a very strong labor market, but there won't be jobs that fit their skill set from before the pandemic. That's going to be painful. It's going to be disruptive. But there's a lot that policy can do to try to mitigate that pain.
And I think we want to speak to the potential cushioning effects and how we navigate that. Before we do that, though, I think we just need to explore this a little bit further, because, you know, certainly long before 2020, we've been concerned about increasing inequities, and we've seen this throughout our economy. These then have been expedited, exacerbated, particularly for minorities during COVID. We've seen widespread bankruptcies potentially changing our economic landscape, acceleration in automation, stark reductions in labor force participation. We've seen this amongst older people, younger people, working moms. So let's go ahead, Wendy, and explore this, because I think this might be where we need to kind of give ourselves a little bit more texture as we think about potential cushions.
We, you know, as you've been saying, and as I think most of the listeners know, we came into this recession with extraordinary wealth inequality. That inequality is starkest and probably most structural when we think about racial inequities in wealth, and who came into this recession with home equity, with financial wealth, and who didn't. And what that means, if you don't have wealth, whether through liquid financial wealth or equity in your home, you have far fewer resources to fall back on when times are difficult. You have far less of a cushion, and so it's one of the reasons why I am extraordinarily gratified by the large steps that policymakers took at the beginning of the pandemic and just recently, because we know that the COVID-19 recession was particularly affecting the families that we knew had very few resources to fall back on. And so I'm immensely gratified that we got them financial resources through checks, through unemployment insurance. And yet we still know that way too many people fell through the cracks. We know that these inequities continued to create financial instability all through the course of 2020. The numbers on food insecurity were continually alarming. We still see food insecurity among children at twice the levels that we saw pre-pandemic. It's very frustrating. And the package that was just passed, the $1.9 trillion, goes a long way to alleviate child poverty. It's gonna cut child poverty in half. Again, quite gratifying, but it's not going to create systemic change going forward. We need to make sure that households come in to recessions, because there will be recessions in the future. We need to make sure that households come into recessions with more financial stability, and we need to make sure that the safety net is better able to reach those families without ad hoc changes by policymakers.
Fiona, do you want to get on this one too?
Well, yeah, a couple of comments to build on Wendy's great great points. So first of all, take unemployment insurance, for example. You know, one of the big expansions of that program came through the creation of the Pandemic Unemployment Assistance Program, which extended eligibility to people who were otherwise self-employed or had, you know, limited work histories who before COVID wouldn't have been eligible for unemployment insurance. And so a big policy question that's looming now that that program has been extended until September is going to be, well, what's going to happen with this PUA program and, you know, unemployment insurance reform more broadly? Should we think about adapting our social safety net systems and policies like that to the workforce of the future? And, you know, I think a lot of people, just as Wendy was talking about dislocation sector to sector, I think there's also likely to have been some dislocation between sort of being a W-2 worker to being a contingent or self-employed worker through the pandemic, only expanding the universe of people for whom something like the PUA program, right, the unemployment insurance program for self-employed is ever more important. So that's one example. You know, another example I would say is throughout this pandemic, you know, one of the two of the groups that we actually compared were renters versus mortgage holders. And, you know, mortgage holders, one of the things the CARES Act did was to provide forbearance, right? And to give people who owned homes another release valve if they needed, or another source of financial relief if they were unable to make that payment. Renters, in contrast, you know, not until the second and third rounds of programs of the relief packages did they have some kind of additional relief. Like that rental relief was very patchwork, and there were some eviction, cancellations and things like that. But it was a very patchwork of support for people who are renters. And so that's just kind of a different kind of segmentation of the population with which we can think about these inequities.
You know, it's also easy for us to have this conversation as we're talking about the national stimulus package, as if the American economy is a monolith. And obviously we've seen tremendously different experiences with and responses to the pandemic state by state. So Ravi, I'm going to come to you next, because one need only look at, you know, New York and California versus Florida and Texas, as I think many of us are seeing people excited to emerge for spring break, whether that's a good idea or not, we could certainly debate. But I'd love to know from your colleagues and your research, what you anticipate for how we see ourselves emerging from a consumer standpoint as we look to the latter half of 2021 into 2022.
I was on mute. I'm not sure behavioral science has as much to offer as if you think about some proverbs. I think it was Bertrand Russell who said about proverbs, they kind of hedge. They seem like wise words, but they have one for each side. So if you look at the pandemic, you know, one way to think about this is out of sight, out of mind. So Wendy mentioned 30-40% of the stuff you're not doing today. Is it going to come back with a vengeance? Many companies hope so. So which is the idea, which is the opposite of proverb, absence makes the heart grow fonder, right? So which is it, out of sight, out of mind, or absence makes the heart grow fonder? So one thing I do teach in, you know, behavioral economics is that often our beliefs drive our behavior. So the reason people didn't try virtual exercising, they had the belief, this is not going to be fun, you know, doing exercising on a video or a Peloton, looking at staring at somebody, or Zoom calls for that matter, and telemedicine for that same matter, right? And my favorite on that is, for me, is the cruise industry, right? Cruise industry is interesting. Half the people are like me who have never taken a cruise and have no intention of taking one. And the reaction is, what the hell do you do on a ship? Like, eat all day? And the other half tell me, who love it, you have no idea how much fun it is and what you can do on a ship these days. And so fundamentally, we have beliefs about these things, right? That it drives our behavior. But the behaviors also drive the beliefs. So during the pandemic, our behaviors changed. We tried telemedicine. We tried digital exercising. And we tried even, you know, happy hours, virtual ones. So some of these things will stick if we enjoyed them. They're like, you know, why did we go every Friday night out for a drink? It was not a rational choice. It was a habit. Like, you know, it's Friday, it's the week. If you thought about it rationally, you would have done 20 other things than go out for a drink. And people got into the habit of a TGIF. that habit is now broken. Does it mean it won't come back? It can come back if whatever replaced it in the meantime is not seen as satisfactory enough in the way to do that. E-commerce is not exactly going away, right? I know a lot of people who are 75, 80 year olds who had never shopped online. They were forced to do it. And now they say, this is pretty good. You know, doesn't mean I won't go to the store. I just won't go as frequently as I used to before. So fundamentally, I think Wendy's right. Some of these things will come back. The predictions on this are going to be very hard because asking consumers will give you the wrong answers because consumers don't really know what they'll end up doing. You're better off looking at other countries where the markets have opened up, like China. You know, what's happened even now, China's been open for a while, many of the cities. What seems to be coming back? What's not coming back? You know, US is obviously not the same as China, but you learn about habits that get disrupted and then which of them are likely to stick and which ones are going to return is going to be a really fascinating journey. And it's going to happen at a relatively granular level, not at a very high level. I'll give you a simple example of granularity. If you look at chewing gum sales, they dropped dramatically initially because one of the reasons people chew gum is when they go out and on social occasions for breath, right? Nobody was going out. So there was a big drop in sales. On the other hand, candy sales went up. You're sitting at home and having chocolate, you know, stressed or whatever, you need any excuse you can find to have a chocolate words, right? So the chocolate sales went up. But as soon as people started gaming the video games, suddenly the gum sales started coming back because people like to chew gum and focus, right? So fundamentally, the reasons that were driving the consumption potentially also changed. And then it became like, how does a company, you know, assign sort of their product to the specific new behaviors that people are engaging in? So to me, the big question for companies are you monitoring the behavior change at a relatively granular level to then sort of understand from a bottom-up process what the macro-level consumption implication will be? Because all of these seem like relatively small things happening, but they add up to a big change in how people are consuming and buying products.
Indeed, and I feel very seen right now by the chocolate consumption discussion, so thank you for that. Let's go ahead and open this up. At this time, I'd like to invite our members to join the conversation with their questions. I'm also going to remind everyone that this meeting is indeed on the record, and the operator is going to remind you how to join the question queue.
Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder to ask a question, please click on the raise hand icon on your Zoom window. When you are called on, please accept the unmute now button and proceed with your name, affiliation, and question. To view the booklet for the symposium, please click on the link in your Zoom chat box. We'll take the first question from Peter Gorovich.
Hi, thank you for these fabulous comments. My question is, how do you target? You've been talking about general macro things, and there are pockets in the country that are regions, I think, or types of people that are severely impacted. And I wonder what ideas you might have, regions that are in trouble or types of people. What ideas do you all have for how we target? Everything is macro. How do we micro? How do we get granular, as Ravi Dhar says, or the others of you say? What are your suggestions?
Well, I can start and others can jump in. So as far as depends on who's doing the targeting, the government versus let's talk about, you know, companies have been targeting all the time, right? So it's very easy for them to know at the zip code level or at the level of demographics, you know, families, what income with Facebook and Google. So the different drivers of targeting are not that hard to access. The question is, you know, are you targeting on the right variables that's going to drive impact for whatever it is that you're trying to do, whether it's delivering message on the vaccine? Let's say hypothetically you have data showing that low income, underrepresented minorities are unlikely to show up for taking the vaccine. Let's call it hypothetical, though there might be some truth in that. Then the question becomes for the government, like, how do I systematically reach out to them? And we know all the people are on smartphones or on social media. And so there are ways to do that. The question really from my mind, which I'm not aware of, is governments really set up to do this micro-targeting? We know our two political parties are. They do a pretty good job of micro-targeting, but I don't have good understanding of what the government does in this area. Companies certainly do targeting a lot.
I mean, two other thoughts. You know, one of the things that we didn't touch on was, you know, the extraordinary toll on parents. And if you just take the unemployment or the labor force participation rate of men and women, depending on whether they're parents or not, labor force participation of female parents had a double dip, right? Initially, everybody fell out of the labor force in April, but then female parents, mothers, disproportionately fell out of labor force again, double dip in September, right? When schools opened back up. And so some of the genius, I would say, of the latest round of the $1.9 trillion relief package is to expand a lot of the relief to parents through child tax credits and the stimulus checks themselves, making them a multiplier of the number of people in the family, regardless of child or adult. Because we know that this country has been, far behind other OECD countries in terms of general family supports and has a long way to catch up. But certainly in the pandemic, that has been felt. So that's one. I think some of the income targeting generally, given just the disproportionate impacts of job loss and dislocation in the labor market for low-wage jobs, low-income sectors, that's a very feasible and helpful targeting mechanism. But, there's also been quite disparate impacts across geographies. And, if you just look at state tax revenues, right, it fell dramatically in, places like Alaska, Florida, Texas, and Hawaii, and and North Dakota, right? And it was basically either is your economy entirely reliant on, tourism or the oil and gas industry, right? Like those are sort of the two unifying theories I can come up with to try and figure out like which states really suffered the most. So obviously there are certain sectors that have been dramatically impacted, the travel and leisure in particular.
And I think we'll have to do more with targeting going forward on targeting workforce development. So like my expectation is that the business travel sector does not come back to where it was pre-pandemic. I suspect that business travel is permanently changed. I think that there will be a number of sectors that face those sorts of changes. And I think that we will need policy to do a lot more with targeting which skills are valuable, which workers need more training, and which people are so negatively affected by the disruptions in the labor market, the persistent disruptions in the labor market going forward, that they need long-term fiscal support to weather that. So I think policymakers are going to have to very carefully target who over the next several years sees persistent negative effects from the pandemic.
Thanks, Wendy. I think I want to continue on this theme a little bit because we know policymakers in the private sector alike are really focused on pushing the economy back to its full potential and cushioning those most harmed. As we've touched kind of on the wave tops of the experiences for working moms, and we do sit in Women's History Month of March, we know full well that the adverse effects that we've had after tremendous gains are very vivid and very real. And so I just love to hear from anyone on the panel, what are some of the best practices maybe we can learn from what's worked throughout Europe that actually could be applicable within the US, or perhaps there are other ideas too?
I am by no means an expert on Europe. And I have actually been a little taken aback at how, despite how incredibly frustrated I am with how things have gone in the United States, that on many fronts, we are doing a better job at keeping the virus under control and distributing the vaccine and doing as much economic activity as we're doing, in some cases safely. How we've done all of those things in many ways better than what we've seen in Europe. But we can learn a lot from the way Europe values its safety net. And they do have, many of the countries in Europe, particularly Western Europe, have a stronger safety net and had to make fewer ad hoc changes to make sure that people were supported, families were supported, young parents are supported than we've seen in the US. So for sure, in terms of structural changes going forward, I think that there's a lot we can learn. It is mind-boggling that we do not have federally supported paid leave, that we do not have federally supported childcare in this country, or beyond the childcare tax credit with all of its regressive features. We saw a lot of good changes that move along these lines in the package that was just passed, but of course, they are all temporary. So yes, I do think that there's a lot we can learn in terms of supporting people across the income distribution and supporting families and getting a stronger safety net. There's a lot we can learn from Europe.
Just one other thought, you know, so much of what Zoom life has done is obviously expose our backgrounds to our workplaces and our colleagues, right? And we've sort of been forced to bring our whole selves to work, our dogs, our kids, everything, right? And so, you know, if we think of the long trajectory of closing the women's wealth gap, closing the income gap, closing the participation gap, some of the places where it's been hardest to close those gaps has been at the top. We still see a larger unexplained gap in male to female earnings ratios at the top of the income distribution than elsewhere. And part of that can be due to so-called sort of greedy jobs, right? Jobs for which you can't, a household can't have two of them because one is greedy and consumes more than its fair share. And so I sort of wonder in the context of employer norms, I think employers have become more cognizant of the mental health, the cognitive loads of our jobs, the things that we are juggling at the same time. It through the course of the pandemic, I hope that those sort of ahas become embedded in our firm ways of working and norms. And one thing I'm watching out for and sort of not urging my firm, my employer, to kind of think about is, as we return to work eventually, right, it may take a new form, right? As Ravi says, we may not and never unlearn how to work from home. And of course, our firms will never unlearn how productive we can be when we are working from home. And so sure enough, many of them are downsizing their real estate footprints and trying to take advantage of this in a medium, longer term way. And, you know, so maybe that takes the form, maybe that's good for, women and more inclusive workforces, because now, I was a consultant in a prior life, like it became untenable to do that and have kids, right? You know, so maybe all that, the fact that some of that business travel won't come back will be good. And at the same time, I do worry about, who's gonna be going into the office and who's not, who's going to exercise the option to not, right? And is it going to be people who have care responsibilities, people who live on the outer perimeter of the city who have a longer commute? And so are we going to end up with, certain people, women, people of color, more likely to take advantage of virtual and others more likely to be in person? And are we gonna kind of reinforce some of the inequities that our workforces have been trying to kind of stamp out? So that, it's hard to say whether, the good will outweigh the potential risks as we continue to sort of innovate and firmly adopt some of the, dislocations that have taken place during the pandemic.
Ravi, you're muted.
I just want to add a little bit on the technology side that it's not going to be static, right? So whatever your Zoom experience right now, companies are already working that in the next two to 5 years, it'll be, like the holograms, the virtual augmented reality. So it's as if you're in the office. Right now it's not quite like being in the office for sure. So there's a lot of stuff happening in Silicon Valley right now, which is trying to speed up the whole process of this virtual and what that experience would look like. And I remember talking to some CEOs. I said, I used to go and, fly across the continent and meet another CEO for dinner and essentially come back, you know, relationship meetings. So a lot of the business travel, again, if you start looking granularly, like why that happens, some are, you know, big part of it is sales meetings. Some of it is just like glad handing and, you know, showing up. And the CFO has seen in the last 12 months, hey, my sales didn't drop that much and my travel budget dropped by 90%. That CFO, he or she is not going to give all your money back next year because the pandemic's gone. So you better get used to working with a far smaller amount. And frankly, a lot of the, you know, people are saying they were tired of traveling anyway. So we'll see what the equilibrium here is. And maybe if your competitors are traveling and you're not, then you're forced to travel anyway, defensively as opposed to offensively. So there's a lot of fascinating stuff, the role of technology that's going to change the how the budgeting will happen, given the CFO's now gotten used to saving all this money. I mean, travel is a big part of most company, Fortune 500 companies, you know, P&L. And that suddenly, they saved a lot of money here. And I don't think that it's about to be given back to all the divisions next year.
We have time for a few more questions.
Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder to ask a question, please click on the raise hand icon. We'll take the next question from Chris Tuttle. Chris, please accept the unmute now button. It looks like we're having some difficulty with that line. We will take the next question from Paul Sheard.
Thank you very much, Paul Sheard, Harvard Kennedy School. I'd like to come back to the central business districts and how they're going to change. I mean, I'm living, you know, in a big city like Manhattan at the moment. How radically transformed do you see central business districts? What's going to happen to all of this real estate, this high-rise real estate, as companies downsize their real estate footprints, which was, of course, something they were trying to do even before COVID?
So my intuition is that the changes won't be obvious to the naked eye. And the reason that's my intuition is that working in a central business district or having your company in a central business district has always been an extraordinarily expensive proposition. And so and as a result, you know, companies have for decades, for centuries, have figured out ways of efficiently working outside of a central business district in order to save that money. And yet, you know, obviously central business districts still work. People still find that working together in, you know, in big groups and those network effects are still very valuable. So my guess is that we will largely go back to wanting to be within, you know, some close proximity to each other. I mean, there's a reason that like real estate around the White House is actually like increasingly expensive, literally as you get closer and closer, like, you know, the feet, I'm being inarticulate, like the blocks that you get closer to the White House, the real estate becomes more expensive. Proximity matters, and proximity is always going to matter. But what I want to caution you in terms of thinking about the consequences of this, is that changes don't have to be visible to the naked eye to have extraordinarily disruptive consequences for labor markets. So central business districts only have to be 5% smaller than they would have been otherwise in order for that to have really disruptive effects on labor markets and businesses that serve those districts. So that's my intuition. Obviously it could be wrong in either direction, but that's my guess.
No, thanks, Paul. And I think we're gonna have a lot of economic geographers considering these agglomeration questions too. Let's take our next question.
We'll take the next question from Lilia Ramirez.
Yes, this is Lilia Ramirez. I was wondering if you have analyzed the impact of the pandemic on entertainment, whether it be the movie theaters or the theater districts in major cities, because obviously they were impacted, but I wonder if there's going to be a new paradigm on how people either go to the theater or see movies.
It's a great question, Lily. I think we saw about $75 million for the NEA and other venues. So I don't know. Ravi, do you want to take this one?
Yeah, I mean, I can start. I think, so I, you know, entertainment is such a broad category. So if you look at, let's separate out the movies from, let's say, theater and other things in places like New York City. I think everything that is, a lot of these are tourist dependent, setting aside the movie piece. And I think the leisure traveler, going back to travel, leisure travel is going to come back. It's already coming back at much faster rate than business travel is. The problem for airlines is leisure travel pays for the gas, right? Airline business travel pays for the profit, right? People who sit in the front of the seats versus back of the plane, which is where most leisure travelers sit. So fundamentally, even if it bounces back to, let's say, 80%, it is not going to be very profitable for the airline industry unless the business travel bounces back. So going back to the entertainment industry, I think tourism dependent, I'm actually optimistic that tourism is going to come back relatively faster when people travel for leisure reason as opposed to business reason. That's going to come back. The movie industry, on the other hand, I think the streaming, and this has been going on before the pandemic, right? The increase in the amount of Netflix and watching movies on streaming and alternative platforms has been increasing. And that's rapidly changed even more so in the pandemic. It has changed the business models for, you know, the studios, how they launch movies and simultaneously potentially releasing it on the platforms, both in the movie theaters. And so that is certainly going to have an impact in the movie industry, which I would treat separately from what it means for the Broadway or the museums, because I think that is very much dependent on both tourists and a solid, loyal, and small but loyal groups. And I think those will be fundamentally more secure, but the movie industry is going to be much more volatile.
Thanks, Ravi. How about this? We have a few minutes left. Let's go ahead and do a quick, maybe round robin before we wrap. We know COVID has just changed our routines, our decisions, our behaviors in so many ways. That's been across geographies, across demographics at unprecedented speeds. So some of these changes will outlast the pandemic. Some we'll be happy to dispatch in a brighter, more vaccinated future. So how about this? Let me ask each of our panelists to offer the most helpful or meaningful or hopeful change you hope will sustain. So if you can name one thing that you hope we will keep after we are at herd immunity, what would it be?
Let's begin. Telehealth. Yes.
You know, I would say spending time with the people you're close to. It's something that got reinforced. And initially the pandemic started, people said, hey, the divorce rates have gone up a little bit. But fundamentally, you find that people enjoy spending time with the people they're close to, and they've been doing a lot of that. Partly they were forced to do that, but on the positive side, I think it's increased people's overall well-being and happiness.
Anything else you want to add? We got telehealth, we've got meaningful time with one another. I've certainly enjoyed spending this time with all of you. Anything else for the good of the order?
Less business travel.
I'll second that emotion for sure. All right, well, an hour goes quickly. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining today's virtual meeting. Thank you to Ravi, Wendy, and Fiona. The video and transcript of both this session as well as the Robert B. Menschel Symposium, the full symposium, including yesterday's discussion with Richard Thaler and Eduardo Porter, will be posted to CFR's website. With that, thank you so much, everyone. Stay well. This concludes today's program.